Dr. Tony Nader, thank you so much for joining us again. It's great to have you back. Thanks for being here.
Chase, wonderful to be with you. Always great.
Our conversation is going to be wide-ranging because we're basically talking about the meaning of life with you here today, which is no small question to tackle. And yet, it's my hope that you can begin by introducing you and your work in your own words, to someone who might not be familiar with your vast body of research, or just give us orient us a little bit for those who are new to you and your work.
I'm a medical doctor, scientist, looked into the brain, psychiatry, neurology. Then I learned transcendental meditation, worked with Maharishi Mahesh Yogi, the founder of the program, and looked into really the mind-body problem, what is the relationship between consciousness and the physiology. And so my really focus in life has been to try to solve the origin of life, the reason why we are here, the big questions that we usually discard after adolescent life because we find there are no real answers. But I thought I really wanted to devote all I know, all I've learned to that quest. And I'm really happy and fulfilled that I feel I found a scientific, logical, evidence-based and explanatory, logic for what is it all about and how we're here and why we're here, the big questions.
Well, it's no surprise that this is part of what is so seductive to me, at least, about you and your work. Harvard trained, neuroscientist, and yet what you speak about, it seems and feels so spiritual and abstract. And yet you found this, this amazing intersection. And it's no secret to anyone who's watching the show or listening to the show today that I'm a huge proponent of meditation, mindfulness. My wife is a mindfulness teacher and awareness teacher and practitioner. I studied with many of the greats. And so I'm in many ways a student of hers as well. And so these big questions that you write so eloquently. We're going to talk about a new book that you've got. You've been on the show before, popular episodes, and it's in part because we're striving to reconcile our own personal experience day to day, which feels, chaotic. I confessed to you just a moment ago that I'm a TM practitioner, which is a morning and an evening. I missed my morning meditation this morning. We have some friends staying in town. They've got a one-year-old baby that I love this child. This baby is so beautiful and amazing. And yet it threw our schedule into a loop. So I feel a little bit off my game this morning. And yet it doesn't change me questioning the meaning of life or asking these big questions. You sit at the intersection of spirituality and of consciousness and science. How have you been able to reconcile all these things into a life that, as you mentioned, you feel so fulfilled and content in your day-to-day? I think that's what we're all seeking. How do you do it?
Well, the feeling of contentment comes from my regular practice of transcendental meditation, although sometimes the hectic schedule can push one meditation one side or the other. But the continuation of going back into the self and back into who we truly are, which is the unbounded ocean of consciousness, one field of pure being. And diving deep again and again into that field gives a sense of continuity, of equanimity, of inner balance, even while we face these challenges on the outside. And the fact that I have been involved with this program for such a long time, and the founder gave me the responsibility to take care of this program worldwide with all our great people who are with us in it. And the fact that we have found that when a group of people practice this program together, we can have an effect even on society, gives me that sense of hope, even though it's not fully achieved, but there is the sense that the solution is at hand And that gives you a lot of comfort, really, and sense of peace about the future. So, you know, looking at it from all angles, one has to have an openness about reality and what it is, and be open to change one's paradigm and not only depend on one's sensory perception, but to also the intellect, and more than that, the experience also, and the power of explaining why and how things happen. So all this coming together gives me, what I would say philosophical, but most likely also scientific conviction that there is a truth which is meaningful and that we can understand as humans.
When you just mentioned that when people get together and meditate, as an example, there's scientific research. I'm gonna botch this a little bit, but there's scientific research where thousands of meditators have got together and meditated about peace, for example, and then crime, for example, in a particular city has dropped dramatically during this window of meditation, in arguably scientifically what the study says is based on people meditating about peace and connection and whatnot. Is that the study that you're referencing when you mentioned people getting together, or are there others? And I'm just adding this for context for people who might not know that this is this intersection of science. This is, we're talking Harvard science too. Can you clarify that for me?
Yeah, there are in fact 116 scientific studies that have been done under different circumstances in different cities, towns, and even on a global level for the whole world, where we have found that when a critical number of people, which turns out to be either 1% of people practicing the basic transcendental meditation technique, or the square root of 1% of the population practicing the advanced techniques, we have a change in society that is noticeable, that is repeatable, reliable, and that is, you know, holds against control groups and control situations and comparison with same times in the different years and all of that. So the studies have been very well documented. And for example, they're published in the Journal of Conflict Resolution, peer-reviewed journals, that show that there is no other explanation for decrease in crime, decrease accidents of the road, decrease hospital admission, decrease violence, decrease conflict, and many positive factors happening in society when this group actually practice this program, which is a program on the level of consciousness, on awareness, diving deep within oneself and enlivening what we call a field of consciousness, which is beyond the limits of like the human physical body, but which permeates society and influences collective consciousness and creates a state of calm and happiness and balance in society, so that even, you know, the criminal on the road who doesn't practice transcendental meditation, supposed criminals, will think differently. He will say, well, why should I do that? I can have a different solution. I can find a different way to be happy or to fulfill my goals. And that really is about how much we are all connected and how much there is a field of being, a field of consciousness that is influenced by our individual awareness. And when our individual awareness rises, or if you like, goes deeper into being, that changes the environment also.
So I'm going to operate under the assumption that the people who are listening or watching, I'm going to take sort of lowest common denominator. Like, great, I get the massive social good, but how does this affect me personally? Because most folks need to start there. And I think I've been practicing for a little more than 10 years now, and I am very overt about how dramatically meditation and specifically transcendental meditation has transformed my life. People have been hearing about it on the show for, you know, a decade now or more. And so rather than, to me, that fascination of like the ability to change and transform society is interesting, but it's often the best place to start with the individual. And you've got a new book titled Consciousness is is all there is. And if, what is the connection between the individual's desire, because I believe this is a desire that we all have, to lead a more connected, fulfilled, I'll just leave it at those two words, connected and fulfilled life, that what role does consciousness, by way of meditation, empower us, help us understand this, and help us basically experience these things that we desire, this connectedness and this consciousness? What's the connection there for us?
There are two levels of connection. One is the value of consciousness in terms of being conscious, being a conscious individual. I just take a simple example. Think of the day when you wake up really well, having slept well, refreshed, the night is good, you've had, you know, a good diet, whatever, you ate early or whatever, there was quietness, and for that night you really slept well and wake up feeling great, and you have clarity of thinking. Now, that day is going to be colored by that. You will feel that things work better, that there is softness, easiness, peacefulness. And even if a big problem arises, you kind of are bigger than the problem and you are able to solve it. It's really under your control. Whereas the day when you're tired, you haven't slept well, you don't feel, you know, well, you feel all frustrated or something, you know, and not feeling good, even a small problem overcomes you, and you look at things from a dark perspective. So what this tells us is that the quality of your awareness, the quality of your physical and mental state together, creating a certain awareness, a certain level of understanding, of feeling, of experiencing, makes a huge difference in our personal enjoyment and creativity and ability to overcome issues. So now imagine there is a technique, a system, which there is, which is in my case, Transcendental Meditation, that systematically, without even necessarily having a long night's sleep, but systematically resets you and takes you back to your inner deep self, brings this clarity, removes the fatigue, from just a mental procedure of consciousness diving within itself, rather than consciousness being on the surface level of the ocean of being, which we usually take as an analogy, as if consciousness is an ocean, and that ocean has waves on the surface, and the waves can be turbulent, can be stormy, can be quiet. And suppose you're just sitting on the surface of the wave and you can only see the wave, your consciousness is kind of limited and narrow as compared to being yourself the ocean. And so when you are the ocean, you are connected with the field of being, with the field of existence that is connecting us all. And that is the source of us all. That's why the book says consciousness is all that is. And there, it's not anymore just the practical effect of being more conscious, more quiet, more clear, but actually it is diving and going deep and taking the resources from the infinite reservoir of creativity and intelligence that is as the source of life, at the source of being, at organizing the whole universe. And you become one with that. And therefore, you really are a master of your destiny. And that's how you are happier, you are more at peace, and you are more creative and actually productive even on society. So it's not something just you take in and you sit and you feel good and that's it. It actually gives you productivity. It gives you clarity in producing things, creating things. And so on the level of achievement in society, it is better. And also therefore, in terms of fulfillment, because fulfillment is based on achievement. Achievement is based on action. Action is based on proper thinking and proper consciousness, proper being. And so that's how it's all connected from a very practical aspect to a very fundamental aspect of living life, being in the reservoir of intelligence and creativity that we have within us.
So that's very profound. There's a lot in there. Let's help someone who might be new to this material understand, when you say the sort of the ocean of consciousness, can you describe, and this is put so beautifully in your new book, again, it's Consciousness Is All There Is, How Understanding and Experiencing Consciousness Will Transform Your Life. That's the new book. And you do a magical job very early on in the book talking about what is consciousness. I was fixated on this morning, rereading it. It's on page 62. If anyone's got the book in front of them, talk a little bit more about it. So this is not, again, there's someone right now that we might posit that we're praying to God, or that if they're a physicalist, like, well, I'm just, how am I arranging the atoms that are in my body? Talk to us about specifically what consciousness is from maybe a neuroscientific perspective. What is it that we are tapping into? What is consciousness?
Consciousness is the ability to be conscious, that which gives us the ability to be aware and to be conscious. So one can say you can understand consciousness by starting by thinking, what happens when I don't have it? You know, sometimes something that is maybe abstract, but also in a sense very real, it comes as a dramatic way by saying, okay, what happens when I don't have something? So then I know what it is and what it does for me. So when I'm in anesthesia or in coma or whatever, I don't have a certain level of consciousness, then nothing really matters. Nothing is important. If you're not conscious, or if one has no consciousness at all, like go into anesthesia or deep sleep, but I'll correct that because these are also states of consciousness. However, you know, we're saying lesser consciousness.
So sure.
Lesser consciousness than
we. Experientially, we're trying to make a point here. Okay.
Right, exactly. And so what happens? What is then your wealth? What is your love? What is your knowledge? Where is it? What does it do to you? Nothing. It's absolutely nothing. So to start with, consciousness is fundamental for us as humans, because without it, nothing makes any sense, or nothing is helpful in any way. It doesn't mean anything. There is no meaning. So life means something in consciousness. Without consciousness, life doesn't mean anything. So consciousness is our direct experience of what it is like to be a human being, what it is like to have love, what it is like to feel the self, who I am, what I am, what it's like to have desire, to have hope, to have expectation, to understand, to feel happy, to feel joyful, what it is like. It's all consciousness. It is through consciousness that we have that. So consciousness is real. And there are some people who have problems with finding where consciousness comes from. And they try to solve it by saying consciousness is an illusion. That's honestly, from my perspective, is very much ridiculous, let's say. I don't want to be insulting to those great thinkers who also can think like that. But it's really escaping from finding the solution of what consciousness truly is. So the realism about consciousness means consciousness is, there is consciousness. Now, the problem is, or the question in philosophy and science is, how does it come about? Is it the product of physical matter organizing itself into a nervous system and then consciousness arises? Is it that there are two values? There is one is matter and one is physiology, emerging from matter. And then, there is something else, which is consciousness, that is added onto that. So this is dualism, which means two aspects. There are one side consciousness, one side is matter. But most philosophers and scientists have given up on this because it doesn't make sense. And how can something non-physical interact with something physical? Okay, so we're left with either consciousness is an emergent quality which emerges from the complexification and orderliness of material structure leading to a nervous system, or consciousness is primary. Now, if consciousness is primary, there is a challenge about that. And the challenge is how the material world emerges, how the physical universe emerges. Okay, we will come to that if you like to discuss it. But in defining consciousness, therefore, from my perspective, from what I present in the book and what I staunchly believe as something scientific and philosophically strong and has powerful explanatory power, is that consciousness is like a field, like you say, electromagnetic field, gravitational field, like that. But it is not a physical field. It's not made out of some energy. It is non-physical, non-material. So in terms of materiality and physicality, it's absolutely nothing. It's nothingness. That is one step in the logic that one has to start getting used to, that there is something that is non-material and non-physical that is actually real, and reality doesn't depend only on physicality and material things. Mm. And so to understand it in a metaphoric way, if you like, because imagination is very easy, it's much easier to imagine something than to think it in an abstract way. Imagine it's an ocean. I think this is a very nice analogy. It's an infinite ocean. Of course, it's not made out of water. It's an ocean of being, which has nothing at all material in it, nothing physical. And that is the field of what we call pure being or pure consciousness. The term pure means it's not, you know, it's not mixed up, doesn't have anything else in it. It's just by itself completely pure. It's like you say, pure gold. That means there are no impurities, nothing. It's pure. Now, this is a pure being, pure consciousness, pure existence. And it is a field that has no limit, that is beyond time and space. And that is what I define as the primary consciousness. That is consciousness. And that is all that there is, in fact. The rest is different ways of appreciating that consciousness. So when I say my human consciousness, it means that I am appreciating that consciousness from a certain perspective, which I call my human perspective. So you can have Chase's consciousness. What does it mean? Means Chase has a certain ability to experience that field from a certain perspective. Tony's consciousness means Tony has a certain ability to experience that field from a certain perspective. So this field is a silent field of pure being, but it has waves. We can say why it has waves, explain that. That's what we go on in the book in detail also. But just to imagine, this ocean has waves. Now, you can be sitting on the surface of a wave, and suppose your ability to see or to experience is only to see the wave, one wave. You don't have vision, you know, humans don't have vision to see what's beyond the galaxies, even though we can use telescopes and you know, satellites and all of that. But usual human vision, again, it's an analogy. We don't need to belabor it too much. But we have a certain vision. You look at the distance, you can see only that much. Now, imagine that you are sitting on that wave and you can only see one wave. So your reality is just that wave. So what you're seeing from the entire ocean is one wave or a few waves, let's say. Okay, yourself, your neighbors, your friends, whatever. So your perspective, your consciousness is able to see that much out of the ocean of consciousness. So that is how we have limited awareness, limited consciousness in the field of what we call the manifest field of creation. So it is not that we create consciousness. It's that we experience consciousness, and we experience it from a certain perspective. And that consciousness that we experience allows us to see, live, know a certain amount of things. Now, what I'm saying, or what we're, you know, going through, why it is important to study consciousness or to experience consciousness or to broaden consciousness, is because exactly like that, you can actually literally see more, experience more, and know more if you broaden your awareness in a spontaneous way by diving deep within ourselves. There is a technology of how to do it. And that leads to a broader perspective. So this is a bit of, you know, some things I threw at you.
but it's beautiful. I think this is what people are seeking. It's understanding the role, like, how does meditation benefit you? And I'm going to play back to you what I thought I heard. So if someone says, yeah, but what's the benefit of meditation? Well, meditation connects us to the experience of consciousness, this unified field that we all participate in. We can see a little bit of it in our daily lives. And the process of meditating allows you to connect more deeply with that, to see more of it, to experience more of it. And it's in that experience, that breadth and depth, that we are more creative, are more connected, have more feelings of fulfillment. That's layperson's terms.
No, that's perfect. Perfect. It's very scientific, very philosophical person's perspective. I'll just add to that, inspired by it. Not that you misquoted me or misrepresented it. You did perfectly. But something else that, you know, to remind the those who are with us today, whether seeing or hearing, or both, is that it's not you're looking at something outside you. You know, when you're on the wave and you see just that wave, you are the wave and you're looking at the wave. So it's not like the wave starting to look at something else. When it sees something else, of course, it's because it sees only the waves. But if you dive deep in the ocean, you start seeing that the waves are all part of the ocean and the same ocean. So when you see more of consciousness, you're actually seeing more of yourself. It's not something outside yourself. So that is the true ultimate meaning of know thyself, or be yourself, experience yourself. Know thyself to be an infinite, unbounded ocean of being. And that is when fulfillment comes truly. And, you know, if we ever want to talk about the meaning of life, actually the meaning of life is to come to that realization that I am the ocean and everyone is the ocean and I am everyone, while being also one wave, I am the ocean.
Okay, we're going to park that one for a second because that's a big one. But while we suspend that just for a moment, I think it's prudent to remind our listeners and watchers that while I've been beating the meditation drum for more than a decade, largely through personal experience and then through seeking myself to learn from folks like you and dozens, if not hundreds of others, it is very common, and I'll cite research from my friend Tim Ferriss in his books, Tribe of Mentors and Tools for Titans, that some sort of a meditation practice, an awareness consciousness practice, was the most common unifying attribute of all of the folks featured in his sort of masterwork, this master research around high performers and people who are connected and unique. It wasn't that they all got in cold water every morning. It wasn't that they all slept 8 hours. It wasn't that those were popular as well, but some sort of awareness practice, consciousness, meditation specifically was the number one, if I'm pretty sure I'm getting this right, connective tissue between all these people. And my personal experience is that once you have experienced that, and I think this is the process, think of it like a muscle that I've built, it is in, you know, experiencing that you know, 1% better every day, week, year, month, or whatever, that I feel more connected, more alive, more unified with the world. I start to see these things in a different, and I would call it more holistic and connected way. My life has been demonstrably better because of this. So this is a plea to anyone who's considering meditation or is dabbling, that this is what, you know, Dr. Tony's talking about. And this is the experience, and people can get there through, you know, prayer. There's all sorts of different methodologies. You prescribe a specific one called Transcendental Meditation. But this is sort of my plea to this. Just please give us a little bit of time and energy, because it is a powerful practice. I'll use your word. It's a powerful technology.
Correct. Beautiful. I join you with the plea.
So one of the things that is a little bit of a head scratcher when I've talked to people who are new to this material has been it's sort of the experience of determinism versus free will, or how do I have freedom when, if I'm connected, you know, if I look deeper inside myself, and then because I'm angry at somebody in traffic, or, you know, I feel this, I experience this separation. I'm me and you're you, and I'm good. And, you know, you cut me off in traffic. And how does that reconcile with, wait a minute, we're all a part of this ocean of consciousness, and there is no other there. We're all the same. Help us understand this conundrum, because it pickles most people's brains just a little bit when I try and articulate it. And you obviously are much more adept at that. So help us understand this for a second.
Well, the reason the question of freedom or determinism comes up is because on the surface level, we feel we are free. We act, we decide, I want to raise my hand this way, I can raise it the other way, I decide, it's me who decided. So that's one way. And everybody is so, you know, adamant that we have freedom, and so fully convinced that it's the best thing. And, you know, politicians talk about freedom, we have freedom, there is freedom. And that's because freedom is a very important part in our life and our well-being and a sense of self and our ability to evolve and grow and make decisions that take us in the direction we want to guide our life to take us in, etc. So that is one side. The other side is when scientists started to study the universe and cut it into pieces, they found there are very rigid, strict laws. You know, if you drop a pen, it's going to fall with a certain trajectory. You can exactly calculate, if you know all the parameters and the variables, where it will fall, what it will do, how it will turn around, and what will happen to it. And like that, more and more laws and laws and laws that are very strict and very rigid have been discovered in such a way that, you know, scientists came to say that if you know the original starting point, you can exactly predict everything that will ever happen. And there is absolutely no place in this case, in this analogy, in this thinking, for freedom. And so this is why it's a conundrum. It's a problem where we believe in freedom. We feel we have freedom, but there is at the same time law. So how to reconcile these two? And this was a big question in my mind based on the paradigm that I present about consciousness. Now, let me say just offhand that freedom is real. We have freedom. But law and strict law is also real and it exists. How can this be possible? Well, freedom to do something is always within constraints. And I'll say why the constraints come. But there is a certain degree of freedom, and freedom increases with increasing consciousness. Mm. Now, as you increase in consciousness, your ability to do and act in a free way is increased. At the same time, you can be free to make a decision, but you are not free for the results of your action. So you can choose what to do, but you cannot choose what the results of your action will be. The results of your action are always going to be 100% deterministic, but based on a number of variables and factors that can include you today, but also what you have decided and what you have done in the past, that can include the environment and what the environment needs, requires, or deserves. And but all of these values are automatically calculated. They are according to strict law, and the results will be very much fixed and determined, except if you change them in the meantime. So that's another thing. So, but because you have freedom. But when you do something, you have created an impulse, and that impulse has to follow strict laws. However, in the essence of life, there is freedom. And the paradigm I present, there is actually no meaning to manifestation. There is no meaning to life without freedom. So the meaning of life is very deeply connected with freedom. It's a necessary requirement for manifestation to happen. And there are degrees of freedom. So if you take a particle, it has very small degrees of freedom. You take an atom, it has a little more degrees of freedom. Take a molecule, little more degrees of freedom. Cell, like that. And then you take a cat, it has much more degrees of freedom. You take a human, it can see more, it has higher consciousness, can see different possibilities that the cat cannot see. For example, if you corner a cat in the corner, obviously, it has only a couple of things that it can do, either, you know, jump at you or run away, trying like that. If you're a human and you corner a human, they might argue with you, try to find a solution, you know, think about it, you know, let's do, you know, better, we can do. There is broader consciousness, broader awareness. So whenever there is broader awareness, we see more possibilities. And when we see more possibilities, we have greater freedom. Okay, Now, every action we do, therefore, has an equal and reaction to it, equal and opposite usually. That's how it works to maintain balance. Also, I explain this, why there is action and reaction in the book. But in any case, every action has a reaction. Now, the reaction can be not immediate. It can be in time later. And that's why later on, you know, you will see the results of your action. So if you plant an apple seed, you're going to get an apple tree, but it's not going to happen right away. It's going to take time. Things happen over time. So you plant your apple seed, you come after whatever, 10 years or so, and you want to eat mangoes, but you find you have apples. Well, you planted the apple tree. This is very strict. The apple tree is not going to give mangoes. And so, as I said, now you can still change the situation. So you want to eat mangoes and you find yourself in front of the apple tree. And if your consciousness is narrow, you just say, okay, what can I do? I have to eat apples. But if your consciousness is broad, you can say, well, I'll take the apples to the market and find somebody who wants the apples and who has mangoes, and they'll give you the mangoes and I'll give them the apples. And that's really resolved. So I can still change the outcome if my consciousness is broad and my intelligence and creativity allow me to actually change the outcome. So we have this degree of freedom. We have also determinism, but we always have the possibility of modifying as we go along whatever we have done before.
This connection that you just made with creativity is something that I personally experienced when I began, you know, really got into meditation. And I couched it in sort of this freedom, free will, determinism argument. You cover it nicely in the book, but I think it's a lot of it scrambles just our day-to-day lives. That's hard for us to reconcile. But this, the idea of expanded consciousness presents us with so many more solutions, options, a myriad of much broader possible experiences. And that's, to me, a foundational, fundamental reason of why this matters, of what if you're looking for a very practical, experiential solution or motivation, rather, that's it. When you are meditating, again, I'm an advocate of transcendental, but you know, perhaps there are other vehicles. You would argue that the transcendental is the best, maybe even the only. However, this is the experience. The lived experience that I have is when your consciousness is more, you know, developed, aware, broad, solutions present themselves to problems in a much more simple and seemingly, I'll say easy for lack of a better word. So help us connect with, how does this all bring up a well-lived life together? If I'm using it through, you know, I'm referencing it through a richer, more human experience. We've talked about connection. I just mentioned sort of a bit about creativity, and you know, there's a very practical way, like creative solutions emerge way more readily, easily when I'm my muscles, my meditation muscles are strong. But how does this connect to a well-lived life?
See, this brings us back again. It's beautiful you put it in the context of freedom and determinism and creativity and all of that, because it also brings us back to one big question out of the questions, you know, we address in the book, is the question of, is it by design or by trial and error? You know, if we want to live a well-lived life, is it going to be deterministic, like there is a design, and then we have to follow that design, which means actually we don't have freedom. So, okay, it's nice to have a design and, you know, things have been designed. But when you say that, you're saying, I don't have freedom. And on the other hand, if there is no design and it's all trial and error, you could go anywhere and you end up anywhere. So how do we resolve, is life and evolution, in order to for us to say how we live a well-lived life or a flourishing life, it has to be according to some reference. And the reference is, what is the meaning of it all? Why we are here? And what are we in tune with, what is the meaning of it, or not in tune with what is the meaning of it? And therefore, you know, we get there. So the way I present it in the book is that there is actually a goal. There is an ultimate goal. There is a meaning to life. So as if there is a design, which means if you are here and you want to go here, you could go like this. Or you could go like this. Or you could go like this. You could go in many ways. But there is a goal. And the goal is to actually discover that we are the unbounded ocean of consciousness, that we are pure beings, and live that fullness of life. So the goal is grand, and the path to the goal is grand, no matter where you are. You can be very low, but if you're moving towards the goal in a fastest possible way, that is what will be meant as living a useful, meaningful, well-lived, flourishing life, because you are growing. You are expanding your awareness. You are becoming more. And that, again, is one thing about which is important. The paradigm presents the meaning of life in terms of being more, becoming more, and becoming more and more and more, until we discover we are everything. It is not like the physicalist perspective, where if everything is physical, then the only reference will be having more, having more, having more. And having more is fine if it makes you feel that you are growing more and you are becoming more. But if you are becoming less because you're afraid, your money, your this, your that, you have headaches, you have this, what to do, then it's making you smaller. You are being owned by the money rather than owning the money, you know, than possessing the things. You are being possessed by things. So, we have to say that having more is great as long as it makes you be more. So to come back to the flourishing life, therefore, we have a path. we are flourishing more no matter where we are. We can be poor, unhealthy. We can have a situation that is not ideal. But as long as we are moving towards becoming more and more in our awareness, then we are living a flourishing, well-lived life. And we are going to get to the goal, to that goal of being the unbounded ocean. And that is where true flourishing is happening. So it is not just surviving, but thriving. Thriving means growing, and growing in oneself, in one's well-being, in one's feelings, in one's awareness, embracing ourselves, knowing ourselves to be everything and everyone, and the sense of self growing to embrace everyone else, because we are that same ocean. We used to see from that little perspective on the surface of the wave. Now we just go down and say, all the waves are also myself, because I am the ocean. I'm not just the wave. I am the wave, but I am also the ocean. And all the other waves are myself, because ultimately I am the ocean. They are the ocean. Maybe some know a little more about it, some know less. But, you know, if they know less, they are struggling and being kicked around and they're in fear and all of that. But if they know that they are the ocean on an experiential level, through transcending, through being established in the self, then they feel flourishing. Then they feel well-lived. Life is well-lived. Then they feel they have grown and grown and grown to embrace all possibilities. So that is how we grow in consciousness and fulfill the purpose of life. Now, on the meantime, we have freedom. We can go right and left and left and right. And every action will have its own reaction, its own results. Some of them will delay us. Some of them will make us go faster. And so as we grow in consciousness, we are in tune with that purpose of life. And when we are in tune with it, you get what we call, we use a term, you know, support of nature. Support of nature means support of the laws of life, because life is meant to go to that expansion of being. And if you are in the flow, moving with the current, you are moving fast and you're arriving faster. And that is how expansion of happiness happens. Expansion of happiness occurs because you are always more and more and more.
If this material interests you, I highly recommend the book, Consciousness is All There Is. Things like why consciousness matters. Well, what is consciousness? We covered a little bit here. The consciousness of one and many, things like manifestation, the techniques for transcending, what is a well-lived life, all of this and more is in Dr. Tony's new book. I want to thank you so much for being a guest and being with us today. You're always welcome here. We'll always have you on. This stuff inspires me and is a passion and a pursuit of mine, and I'm very grateful for your time. Dr. Tony, anything else you'd like to say before we must leave?
Thank you. Thank you for having me. Life is really can be lived blissfully. It's our birthright to be happy. It's not our birth, you know, requirements to suffer and have problems. And that we can do through the expansion of our awareness, our understanding, our creativity, and knowing that we are one. It doesn't matter how different on the surface. That's the beauty of life, is the expression of diversity and differences. As long as at the basis we acknowledge that we are one, then we enjoy the diversity on the surface and allow it to be nourishing rather than a source of conflict.
Well said, and thank you very much. Signing off from Dr. Tony and myself, we both bid you an amazing day.